Hello, and welcome to this month's Food and Farms Berks County Style. I'm Sheila Miller, Berks County's Agricultural Coordinator, and I want to thank you for joining us for this program, which I think will be very interesting because we're going to be talking about farm transitions. And for the past 40 years, National Ag Day has been celebrated in our country, and it has always been held in March, which is the very first day of spring every year. We can always count on that. And in Berks County, recently, Berks Agricultural Resource Network has rejuvenated the celebration by actually awarding to the two babies, the first babies born on National Ag Day at St. Joe's Hospital and Reading Hospital, with beautiful gift baskets. So it's a nice way to welcome in spring, as well as remind everyone where their food comes from, and thankfully thank a farmer that day on National Ag Day. But without our farms transitioning to the next generation, we're going to have a little bit of a difficult time maintaining our leading industry record for producing food here in Berks County. And one of the people here in the state who is helping in making these farm transitions from one family generation to the next, as well as new farmers getting involved that maybe never farmed before, is Darlene Livingston, and she is the executive director of Pennsylvania Farm Link. And just to give you a little bit of an idea before we get started, Farm Link is a nonprofit organization that was started a number of years ago, and Darlene works to try to help farmers transition their farms through workshops on succession planning, as well as beginning farmer topics. She serves as a facilitator and administers an organic agriculture program called PATH, as well as offering very valuable links to a wide array of business topics on the PA Farm Link website. This evening, we're very fortunate to have Darlene here. She's got 40-plus years of agricultural experience, and she and her family have a diversified livestock farm and crop farm, and she comes to us this evening to try and help us prepare, number one, for farm transitions through a very short program tonight. She's going to be our guest as well on National Ag Day here in Berks County. And then in April, we will be having another workshop here to try and get farmers to participate in that, to start thinking about how to keep that farm going into the next generation and the next century. So Darlene, thank you so much for joining us here this evening. And I know we've got a lot to cover, so why don't we just get started with your PowerPoint?
Sure. Well, thank you, Sheila, for inviting me. It is a very important topic, and one I look forward to working with you on, and look forward to working with farmers in Berks County on. The importance of farm succession planning. According to a 2005 survey of Pennsylvania farmers, 40% of the farm operators do not plan to ever fully retire, and that is not as much of an issue as it is the fact that 64% of the respondents had not identified a potential successor to their farming operation. They may still choose to be active in the operation, but they certainly need to plan for the next generation and ensure that they have a successor in place. The role may change, but they may still be involved in the farming operation. And a question, why don't we plan for farm succession? First of all, it's too complicated.
And these are the opinions of people you talked with, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Opinions of people I talked with, and I want to say in the trenches, that's what we've found out. We are too busy. People do not take time. They're busy in the field, busy with their crops, and they do not take time to plan. They must face their own mortality. And none of us want to face what might happen to us someday, so that is another issue. We don't like to bring that up. And we're afraid to bring it up to the other generation as well. We use silence instead of good communication skills. Mm-hmm. And we don't understand each other's point of view many times, and we don't really think of it from the other person's point of view.
And I know sometimes there's a fear of what the answer is going to be if they turn you down and say, no, we don't want to farm.
So, yeah. Right. So there's many things that come into play there.
Mm-hmm.
But some guarantees for succession planning that I tell people are that it will require work. We know that every succession plan requires work. It may not be comfortable to have those conversations with the folks in our family or folks beyond the family if you have a transition plan with someone else. And it does take a lot of time to go through the process, and communication is required.
And which isn't always a farmer's strong suit.
So, exactly.
Know, many times when you're a farmer, you tend to work by yourself,
right,
or have, you know, what animals talk back to,
mm-hmm,
you, right?
Exactly. And many farmers work in the fields and work by themselves because that's what they do enjoy,
mm-hmm,
the most.
Right.
And there's nothing wrong with that, but we just have to get outside our comfort zone.
Right.
I like to bring up some questions that I feel each generation has. And first of all, some of the questions for the senior generation include, what will happen to the farm when I'm gone? They are concerned about it, but again, a lot of times it's handled in silence. What if I need it to live on? Many of our older farmers are concerned about their health care needs and their needs financially throughout the rest of their life. So they are concerned, if they transition, that will they have enough other income to live on. Another thing is they wonder, do I need to treat all the family members the same? That gets into the fair versus equal.
Right.
Which I believe is a personal decision on everyone's part.
Right. And probably one of the more heart-wrenching for the parents to know how to handle that. If they have children who have moved away from the farm, and then they have another child who's very active on the farm, how do you handle that? So it's good that you are there to help them through those questions.
So, yes, very much so. And the younger generation, or the entering generation, many times some of their concerns will be, will I be an employee or essentially slave labor at times the rest of my life? Will it fit my family's goals? Many times the younger generation family goals are different than the senior generation. It doesn't make them wrong, it just makes them different.
Mm-hmm.
And another concern is, will I be able to make a living for my family? Obviously, with more than one generation on the farm, you have to carefully look at cash flow and the needs of each generation as far as their income needs.
Mm-hmm.
And I like to go through a succession planning process to help people begin to think about their goals, but they start with thinking of their values. What is important to me? Then they consider their vision. What does my future look like? And then their mission, which draws on both of those, that will determine how will this farm take me there, and goals can be developed from all those, and what steps are necessary to create my future. Mm-hmm. And I believe those things should be considered separately by both generations, or as many generations as are involved on the farm. I believe they should have come up with their own answers for those questions, and then if they will sit down together and discuss them openly, it's very beneficial to determine the final goals that everyone has for the farm, and to combine those different thoughts and different goals and into one plan.
Mm-hmm. And while we're talking about farms, many family businesses, whether they're farms or any other family business, these are important questions for anyone that is trying to keep a family operation going. So whether it's a grocery store or another type of business, but if it's family-owned, these are important questions for everybody to answer.
You're exactly right, Sheila. Recently, I learned of one situation where a agribusiness had thought about a transition or a succession plan, had not put something in writing, and unfortunately right now, the one gentleman has some health issues that do not allow them to do that at this point.
Mm.
So, obviously, it is important for every business.
Right.
And to do it in a timely fashion. And none of us think anything is going to go wrong with us, but each one of us will face some situation, unfortunately. And the goals, once they are developed, they should be put in writing. That allows for a mutually agreed upon set of goals, or in other words, a memorandum of understanding for the operation or business. They should be specific, clearly state what, how, and when the goal will be accomplished. Provide some deadlines, because that gives you an opportunity to set a goal that's attainable, and then when you accomplish that step and meet that deadline, it'll feel good that you've accomplished one step in your goal process. And make sure they are measurable. That way you can use that to measure your progress that you're making, because I believe that if you take it one step at a time, it will be easy to accomplish, and it will not seem so insurmountable. And also rank them in importance.
Before you leave that screen,
sure.
Give us an example of what you mean by something specific that they would set a deadline for.
It might be even in essentially with the goals and in the whole process of succession planning, it may be a deadline as far as when they're going to transition a certain portion of the operation. It may be equipment first or animals if it's livestock oriented as well. It may be a decision like that, how they're going to go about it, but a deadline on when they want to have that one particular portion of it transition to the next generation. It may be a job commitment as far as who will take over management of whether it be the financial books or it be a particular portion of the farm or some work, whether it's crop work, who will take over the management. Essentially, as you go through your succession, everything should have, may need to have a deadline. And even if you don't meet that deadline, you're still working towards that same goal. Mm-hmm. And it's not wrong if you miss a deadline, but it is something it does help to set up those attainable goals.
Right.
Things that you should assess when you're looking at your succession plan and looking at your goals. First of all, you want to ensure the farm viability. That goes back to the ability to have an income for the generations that are working on it. Obviously, somebody may work off the farm as well with the people that are involved to help with benefits and things like that, but you do want to certainly look at the viability, living arrangements and income needs. Analyze the resources and the environment you have to see there may be creative ways to incorporate another enterprise or operation on the farm if it's needed to increase the income of the farm. Look at the estate planning needs for everyone, not just the senior generation, but we all need to have those in place. The tax implications of your decisions and of any transfers of property. And also have contingency plans, what-if scenarios. And I like to think of that as a buy-sell agreement that may take place if something unfortunate happens that none of us plan on. Maybe someone decides they do not want to be a part of the operation anymore. But if there's a buy-sell agreement, there's certainly a manageable way for someone else to purchase their portion of the operation or to make it a good exit with a happy ending for the family and for everyone involved.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like some of these are going to require some additional professional help at times, perhaps an accountant, an attorney, mm-hmm. Obviously for estate planning purposes.
Certainly.
And financial advisors, perhaps, even with that. Does FarmLink help advise in what direction to go when you're meeting with people, or do you leave that pretty much up to the farm family?
We will help advise in letting them know, like you said, the professional they may need to see. We will not try to tell them, give them professional advice in an area that we're not familiar with. We are there to facilitate and help encourage them and move them forward with their steps, but we will encourage them to seek out a well-qualified professional, as you said, accountant, lawyer, the different people that needs to be involved in the situation, and we will ask them to meet with those people. But many times, if you know what you want to do or establish your plan of how you want to go about your transition or succession, you're more prepared when you go to that professional as well.
Mm-hmm.
But certainly, they definitely need to be involved in the plan. And most of all, one of the most important ingredients is communication. As always, we want to make sure we communicate, and it's I like to bring it back into the plan as well, because it is so important.
Mm-hmm.
And the farm business meeting, that is important, especially in a farm family entity. And I do like to say we transition between, it can be within the family and beyond the family. It can, a farm can successfully move on to outside of the family. But in a farm family situation, things I like to think about within the meeting are to keep the family separate from the business. And we need to do that so we ensure that we're in business roles. And one of the other tips I picked up from other professionals was to meet somewhere other than the family kitchen table. As we know, many family meals, our whole family, that's what your family revolves around in many cases. And if you assume a meeting at the kitchen table, you'll take on your family roles. And we want to encourage everybody to remember to take on their business roles and put on their business hat during the farm business meeting. So we encourage them to meet elsewhere. And it may even be in a shop that has an appropriate seating arrangement or anywhere. Some people prefer to use maybe a public building, such as maybe a room in a church or something like that. There's just various answers to that. Some would meet in restaurants. And respect everyone's point of view when you come into the family business meeting. Everyone should be able to state their point of view, and you need to respect others as you would want them to respect your point of view. And make sound business decisions and seek to remember that many times when it comes to a family business, you might be encouraged to make emotional decisions, but they definitely need to be sound business decisions.
Right. It's not easy because the one generation has a lot of investment, you know,
right,
personally, emotionally, financially. Mm-hmm. And, you know, obviously, especially if it's a family, you want the children to come in, but,
sure,
you know, it's sometimes hard, so.
Right.
Yeah. And it's good that you're there.
None of it is easy, but it is all worth doing, that's for sure. And I like to get into a little bit on fair versus equal, since that is, you know, something that's very important to some families. Equal distribution is easier. It does not require communication. It is a traditional method. It does not require a lot of extra thought or extra concern. It's easy to explain to everyone, but it may not be fair to all the heirs if there are family members who have stayed on the farm and have worked all those years and put in a lot of sweat equity. It is up to the family. It's up to the farm owners, but it is something to definitely consider. In fair distribution, the key concept is that those people who have remained on the farm, their compensation would equal their contribution that they've put into the farm. It puts a value on the sweat equity or the time that they've spent on the farm and remained there and helped make that farm operation successful. And the other heirs, in many cases, if it's explained to the other family heirs, they may understand why there may be a different compensation amount provided for that person because of the equity they've allowed that farm to build during their time there.
Right. Well, and before we go on to the next thing, let's take a quick break.
Sure.
And we'll be right back.
You're watching Food and Farms, Berks County Style on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other stories and information, go to bctv.org.
And welcome back to Food and Farms, Berks County Style. I'm Sheila Miller, and tonight we're talking about farm succession planning, and my guest is Darlene Livingston. And we've been going through a PowerPoint that you have, mm-hmm, and it's been very informative, and as I pointed out earlier, this is not just good advice for farms, but any family business, to take a look at where you are, what your plans are to make sure that that business, whether it's farm or another type of business, continues into the next generation. And we had just wrapped up talking about those family members who stay very active in, mm-hmm, the farm or,
yes,
family business, and how do you treat them fairly and equitably as compared to maybe a child who's moved across the country and, mm-hmm, is no longer really active in that family, mm-hmm, family business.
Definitely. And there are some of the universities, like University of Minnesota, has some resources that will help you calculate, show some calculations that they've utilized in farm operations, as well as Iowa State. And that brings us into planning resources, which there are. We have printed materials that we provide for people. There's an Ag Transitions website that is very helpful, that allows several different people to develop a succession plan online. So that is often a helpful tool, and they can also receive other information, confidential information back about that, about their plan. PA FarmLink, we offer resources online. We do have a database. We also have a facilitator program, as we've spoken, that will help try to answer the questions or move you forward. Just like to acknowledge Iowa State University, Ag Transitions, Virginia Department of Ag, and Keith Dickinson. And I would like to finish by saying that one of the most important accomplishments for the farm, and possibly for the family, is developing a transition plan. And if anyone would like to contact me, my contact information is there, and I would be very happy to meet with them and offer our facilitation services and help farmers across this state.
Okay, and we are planning a workshop here in Berks County on April the 18th. And I'm looking forward to that and making that available to any interested farm families that may be looking to plan for the future.
Sure.
And this doesn't necessarily mean you have to be in your 60s, 70s, and 80s to do this. I think it's important for young farm families to also be thinking about the future, and especially if they have young children as well, and at least take those basic steps that you talked about, coming up with a will or estate plan of some sort.
Right.
And we've done a lot in Pennsylvania for farmland preservation, so we need to make sure that we also make sure that we've got the farmers to actually do the production on those farms, milk the cows, plow the fields, or no-till the fields these days.
Right.
And when I chaired the Center for Rural PA, one of the things that we did was kind of incubate PA FarmLink, and felt that this was so important because we need to be able to bridge that gap. The average age of farmers in Pennsylvania is, I believe, 57 years old.
Yes.
And, you know, it is a concern. It's been a concern of mine for about 20 years now, thinking about how we make sure that we keep that production going with skilled family members. And it does take a huge commitment on the part of the individual to be a farmer, because it's a 24/7 type of job.
Definitely.
And sometimes not with not a whole lot of financial incentives. But one of the things that's helping PA FarmLink is the financial support and assistance from the Department of Agriculture recently.
Yes. The Department of Agriculture is a great supporter of ours. We do have our office space there. That's part of their support of Pennsylvania FarmLink as a nonprofit, and they also support us financially and encourage our work. It's a private public partnership there and has worked out very well, and I do collaborate with people from the department and so on to try to help them in any way I can and utilize their assistance as well.
Right. Now, and as we get close to wrapping up the program, I know that you've helped a lot of people, and you shared with me that you've got quite a few farmers that are actively working with you now.
Right. This spring so far, we have 113 farmers that we've talked to about farm succession transition. It's a start, and that's the main thing. They're taking the first step, and I would encourage anyone else in this region, in this county, in Berks County, to take that first step and come out to your program that you're having. They'll start out just like those folks, and we provide a lot of materials and support for them.
And just real quickly, in the people that you've worked with, is there any specific case that you think of that really hits the point of why it's so important to plan for family farm succession?
I think one was a very successful one. A gentleman had a slight health issue, and then it made him realize that it was time to turn over to his son, who he farmed with, and he did that, and he very happily goes out every day and works with the son, but he said he doesn't have the worry anymore. His son has the worry, and his son greatly enjoys it as well. They still have a wonderful working relationship, but they have made that transition. There are others that unfortunately maybe they didn't work together and communicate as early, and so the earlier you start the better, because some of those may be having more difficulties getting through. I know of another instance that may have had more challenges than that one, because and really just more communication will help everyone.
Right.
And earlier.
Well, farmers work hard, and
yes,
sometimes it's hard to let go of
yes.
that work ethic, and to know what to do and right. how to be useful, mm-hmm. and the ability to help that next generation get going is always important,
yes.
but again, one that is not without its challenges
sure.
as well. I think the main thing is to make sure that you transition that business
mm-hmm.
at a time when it's still very much in production and hasn't been allowed to slip backwards,
mm-hmm. That's
so
a
that
good
you
point.
Maintain everything and keep moving it forward, because we know
right.
that a farm that's not taken care of or neglected certainly is not as productive as it could be or should be.
You're correct.
So,
yes.
Well, listen, Darlene, mm-hmm. thank you so much for coming here to Berks County
sure.
and being part of tonight's program on Food and Farms Berks County Style. I look forward to your participation in our National Ag Day mm-hmm. celebration on March the 21st. The day after the first day of
sure.
spring, and then again in April on the 18th, when you'll be here to actually do the workshop here in Berks County, and we'll get more details about that out in the near future. So again, thank you so much for being our guest.
Thank you.
And that's all the time we have for this evening's program. Join me again next month for Food and Farms Berks County Style.